This is Jeremiah. We're at the last segment of chapter 10, Matthew, and this is one of our last big heavy hitters for this ministry, okay? And then, of course, it's chapter 10, as we have, I'm on 40-something here on my list. Let's get to it. Now, I wanted to mention, of course, the fact that the master is basically telling them, beware, and the word beware means watch out. So, you know, watch out, and he also says, be as harmless as doves, and wise as a serpent, meaning be very cunning, use your head. Don't be sloppy thinkers around here. Utilize your wisdom and your tact and use procedural thinking, you know what I mean? Think ahead, forethought, you know, and that's what he's saying. So that's a big part of what's going on here as we continue. So the only place, the only place for anyone, for the human to go for freedom is in Christ. Whom the Son has set free is free indeed. He who has the Son has life. He who has not the Son has no life in him. So all humans are in a jail cell, essentially, psychologically and spiritually. And the only way out of the jail is the key, Jesus Christ. And this is good news. And the disciples are those who are bringing it to the masses. And the first people who are being saved in this 2,000-year church period are the homeboys, we might say. The master said, don't go to the people out there and the Samaritans far up north of Jerusalem and so forth. They're basically Gentiles. Now, some of them are mixed with some of the 10 tribes, which are not Judah and Benjamin. Probably a lot of Levites, too. I have not done a lot of demographics on that. But as many of you know, Solomon and David, they kicked all of the Gentiles that they captured to the north region for captivity and slavery. And the people who took care of them were the 10 tribes. They were their supervisors. And unfortunately, the 10 tribes began to mix with these people who were not strong, head-on, 10 commandment, love God, love your neighbor, forgive your neighbor, mercy practice people. I just did some history on the Scottish-Irish people who came to the United States. And they were more or less kicked out of England and so forth. That's in between England and Scotland. They were called crackers. Because they didn't want to be educated, they didn't want to work hard, they wanted to drink, and they were violent. They were basically Jerry Springer kind of white people, and they were bad news wherever they went as a community. Andrew Jackson is from that group. Although Andrew Jackson evidently had much more class than his family and demographic there. Because when they came to eastern Pennsylvania, not too far from here, the Pennsylvanians went into shock. Because they didn't want them there. They were lawless, they were drunk and lazy, and they were a group of people, and they had feuds all the time, and they were very violent, and they had honor fights, and I think that's where the Field of Honor came from. With the pistols. Okay? And the master said, don't go to these people at this time. And of course, the master talked to a Samaritan woman who was very wild. As a matter of fact, that was one of what you might call the temptations of the body of Jesus Christ. Because the woman was at the well. And the only women that go to wells, they're not supposed to go to wells. Those are basically wild women and so forth. And the master told her he would provide her thirst quench, having so many husbands and so many male friends and so forth. She was never happy. And there's no happiness without the Holy Ghost and the law of God. You won't find happiness. You have to have the spirit and the law of God. You have to have the spirit of grace, and you have to have rules and guidelines so that you can establish those guidelines. Okay, let's get going. This is Jeremiah with New Covenant. We're in Matthew chapter 10. We're just about ready to wrap it up. I'm going to turn the page momentarily as we just go over a few things in this chapter. As many of you have read this chapter, there are too many things to go over. I mentioned the hairs of your head are numbered. We mentioned quite a few things here in the chapter, but I'm going to move on. I'm not going to go through everything because it would take too much time. But I just want to basically remind you that, or mention, to recap just a little bit, that this is the first Great Commission. but it's not the Great Commission, and that is to get out there and use the healing powers I'm going to give you to attract the gospel. Nothing attracts the gospel like a blind man running around saying, I can see, and you knew he was blind since birth. That's going to draw attention to the master. He wants attention, and he wants people to ponder and think about the power of God and the salvation in the message of the gospel. Because your soul can't be saved unless you get it saved. You leave the maybe area of, I didn't hear the gospel, I might be saved. This is what's wonderful about the 2,000-year gospel of Jesus Christ. You leave the maybe field. In other words, if you're in a jungle somewhere and you've never heard the gospel and so forth, your assessment on the Lord's Day is based upon what you know. Essentially. And that is why we have Abraham's bosom for 4,000 years. We have people who died and went into Abraham's bosom, and they were a select group of humans of Adam's children. Based upon their behavior and God's assessment, they're not in hell in the fire part. They're in the hell part, which is the waiting area. They're waiting for Jesus Christ to legally purchase them. After Jesus Christ has legally purchased those people in Abraham's bosom, they're going to rise up on Resurrection Day and walk around the town. They're going to be able to walk around town because legally they can be free, because Jesus Christ successfully took their sins and bore their sins and all their griefs and all their sorrows. He's the scapegoat. We get beauty for ashes that we deserve. And so therefore, we mention that these people that are being saved, some of them have not heard the gospel. All they know is the law, and they know a few things. But as far as having criteria for whether they go to the bad part of below or the good part below, because there are two parts below before the resurrection of Jesus Christ. There's the fire part for people who thoroughly disobeyed the commandments of the Lord, and then there's the good people, so to speak, and they're in Abraham's bosom, which is a separate area down below. That area is no longer exists. Those people have been resurrected, and they're in heaven. Okay? Now, evidently, they're going to be resurrected again and so forth. We won't get into that. Now, let's get going. So, Jeremiah, there are two places down below for 4,000 years. That is correct. So we have one basic worker here and who teaches, and it's good news, and people can be saved, and everybody's going to get their names written in the Lamb's Book of Life who accept and put their confidence in the gospel, death, burial, resurrection, forgiveness of sins, and the grace of God has come to you, that you can get something that you don't deserve. But you're going to have to love God in response to being saved. He's demanding that you love him at conversion. You're going to have to legitimately love the Lord. That's the royal law. So repentance has tied with it number three in this ministry, which is the big trifecta. You're going to have to love the Lord your God with all of your heart. You're also going to have to love your neighbor the way you love yourself, and you're also going to have to love people the way God loved them, Jesus loved them. And that means you're going to have to take your care game up. Through the power of the Holy Spirit and the guidance of the Spirit, you're going to have the ability to allow yourself to become a very, very, very caring person. If you block that, you're toast. The Bible calls it hardening your heart. Okay? That's called non-compliance to the commandment that's required of you. It's required that when you, upon conversion, you open yourself up to doing deeds that are in line with loving your neighbor. You're going to have to do that. Now, most people who are converted, or a lot of them, they're going to do what they're supposed to do. In the rapture, the master basically says 50% of the population we see right now, they're going in the clouds. The other 50 are going to stay here because they weren't love Jesus' command compliant. They walked through the church like a looky-loo. They were looking at the gold. They weren't dressed properly. They never became spiritual. They were Starbucks kind of Christians, which means they were never really the church. They were looky-loos, greedy people. They may have declared that they have professed objection to Jesus Christ, but they didn't. And we see that clearly when the master says, why call me Lord, Lord, if you don't do what I tell you to do? I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Oh, didn't we do this? Didn't we go to church? I will tell them, I don't know you. Get away from me, you worker of iniquity. So any practice of sin disqualifies you, even though you hang around the church. That's the point the master is making. And a lot of people are going to be practicing this, practicing that, but they're going to profess that they are subjective to the law of God. And they're not subjected to the law of God. And the law of God is you must practice righteousness. End of story. That's called the narrow path that only a few walk on. Most people like Broadway. Many there are that go the Broadway. Jeremiah here teaches a narrow path so you can own your soul. Soul ownership. Okay? That's what 24 in this ministry is. There's a war for the ownership of the soul. When the demonic witnesses knock on my door, they're fighting for the enemy because they're going to tell me things that are going to disqualify me for being saved. They're going to toss away the critical criteria for me to be saved, such as Jesus is a frog or something. No, you must honor me even as you honor the Father. They knock on my door and say, don't honor the Son even as you honor the Father, which is a clear commandment for a 4th to 8th grade grammar student who's paying attention. Unless you do this, you will die in your sins. Okay? So they're telling you, don't do what he said do. So that means, if you listen to them, you're going to die in your sins. The demonic witnesses are going to do what? They're going to die in their sins. That's called living bread. And they're trying to snatch vitamins off your table so you die. People who knock on your door with these lies, they're trying to get the vitamins out of your food. And if you let them take the vitamins out of your food, it's on you. I don't want vitamins out of my food. I want the vitamins in my food and leave it alone. And that transfers metaphorically or to soul food. Let's continue. So the division is, the Lord said, I have come to separate people. And I didn't come to bring peace, but a sword. I'm going to have people turn on each other. There are going to be people in the family who love wickedness, and you're going to tell them that they're wicked and that they're going downstairs, and they're going to hate you for doing that because they enjoy their lifestyle and they enjoy the sin, and they want you out of here so they can enjoy their sin in peace. Also, they don't want you taking their friends away from them. If I tell a homosexual person to get saved, I just removed a homosexual person for another homosexual, and I just reduced the pool of the fun they're having in sin for a season. I just messed up their pool. And nobody wants their numbers damaged because there's fun in numbers, isn't there? I used to live in West Hollywood, which is one of the main meccas for homosexual people, And they say that each one of these people walking around dressed as women and whatever they're doing, they say that they have 50 partners in romance a year, the average person. We're not going to go into detail on that. I'm just telling you that the world is wild, and the worse off you are, the worse off you usually behave. Let's put it that way. Let's get going. So the division is to separate families. And you're going to cause a war in a family when you pick Jesus and they don't. And the master says, basically, whosoever wills, come unto me. So, same thing as let this mind be in you. You're going to have to allow. And then when you start getting on the tough road, you can't be ashamed or offended at the tough road of daily cross. Daily cross, daily cross, daily cross. And I have a lesson on that, which is, what is that? That is seeking not deliverance, not accepting deliverance. I don't want to be free of my yoke of Jesus Christ, of being a soldier in tough times. I don't want to be free. I don't want to be a pudding eater on a yacht with some semi-homosexual Bible fake teacher taking a bunch of people to Alaska. I don't want that. I want to go across the street and get in the mud and help a sister so-and-so across the street. That's what I want to do. They asked Livingston, Dr. Livingston, who went to Africa, one of the most influential people in the history of the world. He basically saved half of Africa, one man. And Stanley told him, why don't you come on back with me and you get a doctor because you had malaria and you can get some health, more health care and have some pudding and relax and get better and not be around cannibals and wild animals and so forth. And Livingston told him, I want to be here. In other words, the scripture that says not accepting deliverance is exactly what Mr. Livingston did. And Stanley went back to England and told his friends who were eating pudding, he said, you guys are soft pudding eaters, and Livingston is the real deal. You Londoners, you're basically a bunch of pudding eaters. I take good care of myself. I stare in the mirror. I have parties, and I eat pudding, and I'm a decent guy. Doesn't mean I'm not saved. It means you're not really verifiable, servants of the Lord. Livingston is verified. And he's not saved by his works. He's saved by his love of God and mankind. And that's what Stanley knew. Stanley was a very bright individual. Stanley came from London. He went to New York. Then he went back to London. Then he went back to Africa looking for Livingston. That was his newspaper duty that he took from New York. He went back to England and said, you guys are pudding eaters, and Livingston is helping Africans, and he's changing the entire continent by himself. He has a deep love for Africans, even though a lot of them are very confused. He's giving them time and chance, and he's letting them develop, and he has a church, he has a satellite of churches, and this man is what we call boots on the ground, the real deal. He's doing exactly what the master's giving these guys a commission to do, and it's wonderful. And Stanley, of course, is very impressed by this. He ends up taking over when Livingston dies. He leaves a beautiful woman in the process. I'm going to go do exactly what Livingston did. I don't want pudding. I don't want luxury. I don't want all of it. Let's go help the Africans. Let's save souls. And so that's exactly what they're doing here. Because at the end of the chapter we're getting to right now, the master says, he who loves his life will lose it. A lot of these pudding eaters that Stanley came back from Africa to visit, which was his original town, because he went from originally London to New York. Then he went to the Native Americans and interviewed Native Americans. Then he went back to New York. Then he went to, where did he go? He went back to London and said he was going to go look for their compatriot, the cartographer doctor. Livingston was quite an amazing person. Evidently he was a doctor and a cartographer and some sort of horticulture expert. I don't know anybody, but he was also obviously a minister and Bible teacher. He started a lot of churches in Africa, and this guy's an amazingly wonderful person. We're not praising him. We're just saying that we can basically tell that he loved God and he loved his neighbor. And we can just it's a done deal. the pudding eaters that Stanley came back to tell that, that Livingston's alive. They didn't know whether he was alive or not. And he told him that he was alive. They were, oh, we don't know if he's alive. We don't believe you. And he called them pudding eaters, sitting around having pudding tonight and living a life of semi-luxury. And they're not really people who are out there saving souls. Now, there was a Salvation Army at the time, and some of the Quakers were still in England at this time, if my memory is correct. It's not as though there were no churches, it's just it wasn't popular in England. The church was not popular. Unfortunately, the Catholic Church had some popularity, and that's very unfortunate. As many of you can tell, a lot of Protestants left England, such as the Pilgrims and William Penn. And in some ways it's happy for us, but it was also bad for them because they needed that testimony, even though as they were being abused, William Penn's wife said, let's get out of here, go get a colony somewhere. That's nice to escape and so forth. However, it's also nicer in many ways to stay right there and fight and be abused and beat on and because you're going to save people in the process. If you leave, there's no one, there's no voice, there's no town crier for salvation and peace. So it's a double-edged sword, isn't it? Cuts both ways. So the master's going to talk about all of these soul-saving men going out there, and the enemies are going to face. They hated me, and you're going out for the sake of the name. The name means God's going to save people. And the enemy of the world and the flesh and the devil, they don't want you to save people. You're bringing true love, honor, care to men. And a lot of people hate all these attributes. I'll be right back. Here we go, our last segment. Let's do some rapid fire as we wrap this up. This is Jeremiah with New Covenant. We're wrapping up chapter 10, and we're transitioning into short, quick videos now, and that's what I'm going to do, okay? I just gave a lesson on Catholicism and the Quran, which is pretty involved. I probably won't do that ever again. I'm going to just mention a few things from now on, and I'll tie in something at the end of the video, which I've mentioned quite a few times. Let's move on to the lesson germane here. So we have evangelism, we have a duration of time that these men are going to be out there, and the master says that you're starting something that's going to stop at the second coming. In other words, the gospel, the everlasting gospel will be preached, the testimony of Jesus Christ, for 6,000 plus 7 years or so. And it's going to happen, and you're the first ones who are going to share this instant salvation for mankind, and no longer are you in the bubble of where you're going and so forth. And it's guaranteed salvation is wonderful. And that's the end of the world mentioned here, and of course we'll get to that in Matthew 24, something later on. So the disciplined ones are saints now. The Bible uses the word discipline. Paul starts using the word saint. It means basically the same thing. It means you're disciplined and you're hungering and thirsting after a holy life, a pure life, an honest life, and a clean life that's pleasing to God, and you're being trained before you get ready, and now you're going. And we're going to have graced converts now. Paul takes that word discipline, and he uses the word saint for that word. Saint means devoted to purity. That's what discipline is. Okay? Discipline leans more towards behavior specific, and hard work and stick to it mentality. It's 5 o'clock in the morning. I got to get up. I got to get up anyway, even though I don't want to get up. That's what discipline means. But the word saint is used by Paul that basically means the same thing. It's a devotion to a lifestyle, and it has a lot to do with not just being holy and pure. It has to do with discipline, because discipline owns purity. You can't be undisciplined and be pure in terms of your life, your schedule, and so forth. So it is not, you're not above the master here. The master's going to talk about that. You can't be above the master, which is basically what's going on in the falling away. A lot of people walk into a church or call their building a church, but they want to be above the master. They do not want to teach the humiliation required and the fellowship of the sufferings of Jesus Christ. And so that means you want to be above the master. You're a gold brick. The master said you will have tribulation, but you come on TV and say you will not have tribulation. The master says that you must put my yoke upon you. They say, I'm not going to put my yoke upon me. The master said the seed must fall on the ground. They say, I'm not falling in the ground. But yet they tell you that they're some sort of leader or some sort of follower of Jesus Christ. And they just contradicted one of the main principles and teachings of the master himself, which means they're clowns. They're either their brain's not working at a near a function it should, or they're just being dishonest and they're pushing away the truth. One or the other, right? Or both, you know. I don't know the psychological profile of people who want to be above the master. Let's keep going. So many are called, few are chosen. So go out there and see who's worthy and who's humble. That's what worthy means. They're ready to love God. They want to learn about loving God. That's what worthy means. They're worth your time, and they're worth God's time. And can they be confident in this simple gospel truth message? And once they do that, they become the enough and sufficient and overcomer category. Faithful, well done. Wise. All these terms apply to the winner here. The Nike, the winner. Putting confidence in not being above the master, but doing what the master did, which is drink the cup over and over again, which Jesus asked John's mother, James and John's mother, and possibly Jude's mother too. He told her, can you drink the cup I'm going to drink? In other words, do you want to be above me and walk around here and eat soft pudding and be undisciplined and be unholy and so on? Are you ashamed of going through a difficult circumstance like Mr. Livingston? Are you offended at going in the jungle? And if you are, then you're not enough. You're not sufficient. You are ashamed and offended. And there's only two categories here that are diametrically opposed to one another. And that is enough, sufficient, overcomer. And then there is lazy, I'm ashamed, and I'm offended category. There are only two worlds here. So confidence in this immersion of a baptism and ready to put boots on the ground to your baptism. The master was baptized, and then he was placed into a position where he was going to allow himself to be buried. Is that hard to figure out? No, it's not. So salvation and deliverance is something coming to these people who are going to who are not going to be doomed anymore. People who are hurting psychologically, they won't be hurt psychologically anymore. That's all done by the burial of these men, falling on the rock, falling on the ground, putting on the yoke of Jesus Christ, the permanent slaveryhood, and the daily slaveryhood of a daily cross, and holding it, and we have winners on our hands here. They're doing as told. These gentlemen are saved now. One of them is going to walk away from this, and they're going to be ashamed and offended, and they will not be enough and sufficient or an overcomer. There's only two fields here. Winners and losers. The burial or falling on the rock, something you're going to have to do. The master said, fall on the rock. Now, did he make you fall on the rock? No, he asked you. Basically, for you to fall on the rock. I was talking with a Bible teacher here the other day. He said that the Lord makes you fall on the rock. Nonsense. This man shouldn't be teaching the Bible. I wanted to take you in as a hen takes in her chickies, but you wouldn't. What does that sound like? He made you? A hen doesn't make her chicks mind and come into the safety. The hen will coerce you. The hen will push you. The hen will yell at you. But the hen will not make you. Can't make you do that. That's called will. Free will. There's a Greek word for that. Let's move on. So the situation is that we have salvation coming to men and based upon burial and take up your cross daily and to the end. You're going to have to, he who endures to the end shall be saved. Very simple. The Christianity is basically two periods. There's initiation successful, and then there's post-initiation successful, which the parable of the sower explains for you very simply. You need to start studying the Bible and learning about love and truth, and you need to keep on studying the Bible, learning about love and truth. And both of these periods are essentially done in humiliation and not seeking deliverance and allowing yourself to be lowered, just like the Master. Not being ashamed of being lowered and taking the low table. The same table he took. That's why Jesus asked John's mother, can you drink this cup, Mrs. Zebedee? Can your boys drink this cup? That we can get down to brass tacks. And the bottom line here, if you really want to know about being saved, then tell me that you're going to face the challenges of a born-again Christian person, not just in the initiation process, but in post-initiation, because initiation can cause problems. The devil can confront you on proper initiation. Look around the corner. They initiate people into so-called Christianity when you're 2 years old. You don't know anything about repentance and confession of sins when you're 2 years old. Yet they have you confessing your sins at 2 years old. They have you talking to a man called Father and confessing things to him. When the Bible clearly says, our Father which art in heaven, you're supposed to pray in secret and then confess your sins that forgive us our debts to Father. So they've taken the place of Father, and they've taken the place of a place for you to pray and confess your sins, and they've taken the place of you're saved by grace. Now you have to go pay penance and go climb rocks and scrape your knees on the ground. Then you're saved. Go buy some candles. You can get a husband. That the vision of the woman said to the girls, go and pay penance. That's the devil talking. We have a song here, Jesus paid it all. But I don't pay for anything. I'll be right back with the last segment, Maranatha.